All right, we are ready to take off. Ooh, and it's warm. All right, as soon as we get going, here, I'll put the AC on. And that's still going, everything is good. All right, so let's take off and then we can start talking about what we're doing.
Sure.
Now, where were we? So we're continuing.
How are the cameras working today?
Well, let's see, the cameras. Is that the voice working? I hope the voice is working. It's all plugged in, everything should be working. Oh man, now you got me all spooked about the voice.
No,
good, everything's good.
We're great.
So it's Marie Langer and Nick Zentner, and we are headed out of Malaga, which is where we were when the cameras died last time. And we'll give you another view of this wonderful junkyard in front of us.
Yes, good times here.
We've got the camera mounted in a different position so that we don't have to worry about our excited hands blocking any views. I know some people were uptight about that.
Get over it.
That's right, get over it. Get over it. So we were just, actually I guess we were higher in the last video, and we had, we talked about the Malaga slide, we talked about the Pangborn bench, we talked about this whole area behind us, and we were just starting to talk about this narrow spot in the river here where this trestle goes across, and you were probably saying something really interesting about that, or the area, and of course it's gone.
You never know if it was interesting or not, but we can try again, sure.
Okay.
I mean, this Rock Island area has its own history, its own interesting history. Some of these actual cliffs right down here by the river are the actual bedrock CRBs, Columbia River Basalt Lavas, and then your big landslide, that Malaga slide, kind of came down here and blocked the river, and so it's a mixture of landslide blocks and just kind of bedrock knobs, essentially. That's kind of why it's so narrow in here. I think we were talking about that.
Yeah.
And this is the Rock Island Dam. It's the first dam on the Columbia, much to my surprise.
Oh, is it? Okay.
Coming up straight ahead. So this is one of my favorite parts of Washington, and to be able to fly over it with you, it's a dream come true.
It's a lot of fun. It's a lot of fun getting to learn about all the geology of the area. It's really easy just to say, oh, look, Ice Age floods, and then there's a bigger story. Obviously.
There is. However, the headline is the Ice Age floods, and I hope I don't just go too crazy on that, but that to me is the big story here. If we can picture, we're flying right down the Columbia Valley, just like these Ice Age floods came right in the direction that we're flying. Many times, we're still not exactly sure how many times, but each time there was a big flood, we're talking about 50 mile an hour water, 1,000 feet deep, bringing a bunch of rocks in here, dropping a bunch of gravels, and we can look for specific clues today, for
right.
Sure.
Good, good. So we're coming up on the Rock Island Dam, which is right ahead of us. Let's see, the camera looks, it's like a wide angle view, so
okay.
It looks like it's kind of far away. I'm looking at it here.
Well, that's perfect, actually,
yeah.
Because what I'd like to point out here is straight ahead across the river, can you see a bunch of little milk duds? A bunch of little black dots, basically.
Those, right
on the flat.
Uh-huh.
So that whole thing is a landform we call Moses Flood Bar. So everything that you see came down Moses Coulee by 5 big ice age floods at least, and there was this incredible belching of material that kind of dumped into the Columbia Gorge here. So even on the right side of our view, so both this thing on the right and that thing on the left, it's not an accident they're the same elevation. They all used to be one big, basically a big dam on the Columbia River. So there was a lake in Wenatchee for many years because of the plugging of the Columbia River Valley here.
And just remind us how many years ago this was.
Well, this particular event was 16,000 years ago.
Okay.
And we know that because we can now study some of these boulders. Hopefully you can see them now,
yeah.
Viewers. These were all carried down Moses Coulee and all dumped here at the same time. And we can study the surface of these boulders and actually figure out how many years they've been sitting there exposed to cosmic rays. I know that sounds like science fiction, but that's the latest technique to get an actual age for a particular date. So everything you see on this level down below us was brought in here quickly, and there was so much material that it blocked the Columbia River.
So since we're talking about Moses Coulee,
yeah,
and the entrance to Lower Moses Coulee is right here, I figure we may as well just take a little flight up Moses Coulee.
Impulsive, right.
And I just want to point out to the folks that watch a lot of my videos, if you watch the one where I fly down to Crescent Bar,
yeah,
you might recall that we were buzzed by two military aircraft. I thought they might be A-10s, but someone else said they were something 818s, or I have no idea what they were, but they were fast, and there were two of them. They do their practice stuff coming down this coulee.
Okay.
So though we didn't see them here, we saw them further downriver, but they had come tearing down this coulee.
Oh,
and
Lord,
hopefully if there's any today, they're higher than us. They should be. This is kind of low. And they come down here and they make that left-hand turn to go down the river. And a bunch of years ago, and I don't remember exactly when, I was told about it. It was before my time here. One of them didn't quite make the turn. It kind of pancaked into the cliff there. So now we're going up Moses Coulee, and I need to make a statement about this. I'm from Arizona before Washington, and I used to fly over the top of this coulee on my way from Quincy down there to Wenatchee over here, and I used to look at him like, how could this giant canyon have been made by this little creek bed? I don't know if you see this little thing snaking down here. That's, I think it's called Douglas Creek. And it never made sense to me until I went to the Grand Coulee Dam, and I went to the visitor center and I watched the interpretive video, and that's when I first heard about the Ice Age floods. And this is so obviously, this coulee is created by that. So tell us more.
Well, you were thinking like a geologist, whether you knew it or not, and that's all that we do. We just think these relatively basic questions to ourselves, just like you asked, how are we going to form a valley like this if we don't have a river? And that's the first thing to notice, and maybe that anybody can notice, regardless of your background. Where's the river? How can you make a canyon like this? It's not just a dinky little valley, it's a huge canyon. How are you going to make this without running water? And that was a debate for much of the 20th century. There was a guy named J. Harlan Bretz. I don't know if you've heard that name before.
Probably in one of those videos.
I'm really into him right now. I'm doing a new lecture on J. Harlan Bretz because he single-handedly, 100 years ago, back in the 1920s, was coming up these valleys on foot and horseback, and also an old vehicle when they were first putting roads in. And he was piecing together all this wonderful evidence for these incredible Ice Age floods. So that's the basic story. This is a coulee. Coulees form when you actually rip out a bunch of bedrock in a very short amount of time, like days, not weeks,
yeah,
not
okay,
months, not years.
And
go ahead.
No, I was just going to say up ahead, and I'm not sure how well it's showing up in the video yet.
Yeah.
I think I might have to change the view to be a little bit closer.
Okay.
But there's an area that the local people around here call it Palisades. There's actually a little, I don't even know if it's a town because I don't think it's got a post office, but it's called Palisades. And those cliffs up ahead remind me from my Grand Canyon piloting days of the Palisades of the Grand Canyon, which are on the east side of the Grand Canyon, east of a lot of the lookout points. And the Grand Canyon has cut out obviously a much larger canyon, but over near the top they've got the same kind of formations of red rock instead of brown. So that's what this reminds me of.
Well, that totally works, and you know, that's really the best way to showcase why this is such an unusual valley. I know you've got plenty of editing to do and you don't want to go crazy with your editing, Maria, but to really do this, we show some kind of view looking up a side canyon or the main guts of the Grand Canyon, and we can see all those, I'm going to use my hands now, I might block somebody. We've got, in the Grand Canyon, you can hike to the river, right? You can just gradually work your way down on the sides of the Grand Canyon until you get down to the Columbia River, and that's what a lot of people do. Well, here, you can't do that. You start up high on either side. Look at those sheer walls.
Yeah.
You don't really have that in many places in the Grand Canyon. That's because the Grand Canyon is a gradual development with a river cutting into the earth and the earth uplifting. This is the opposite. This is no river. There was never a river in the history of this valley, and instead, monumental amounts of water coming straight at us at the windshield of the helicopter here and ripping out a bunch of the bedrock. And there's all sorts of evidence, including these shear walls and these things we call hanging valleys. Now, some of the shadows up on the right especially are perfect for this right now. You can see it's a dark shadowed cliff, and then there's an open area, and then another dark shadowed cliff and an open area. Well, we call those hanging valleys, the open areas.
Right.
And the idea is you could have walked once upon a time down to the road, but now because of these corrosive, wrong word, catastrophic ice age floods to rip off the face of those ridges, those side valleys are left hanging high and dry
right.
above the valley. And those are textbook examples here.
And then the other question I wanted to ask is how we've got the valleys got two different depths here. The green where there's straw, whatever, hay growing down there. And
yeah.
then there's a little climb of, I don't know, 50, 100 feet.
Yeah.
And then there's actually another shelf over there. And then it goes up to these slopes that have cliffs, but they also have the talus rock. Is it from multiple floods?
That's one answer,
okay.
But the other answer is, I think we would have had these different levels even if there was just one flood, because some of these lava bedrock layers are more resistant to erosion than others.
Okay.
So this floor guy here is called the Grand Ronde lava, and it's particularly stubborn to erosion, so it's tough for the floodwaters
okay.
to cut into that guy. But up here it was easier to haul these guys off because there's a lot of columns. And columns are easy to kind of pluck off
okay.
from the walls. And then these sloping guys are talus slopes. That's material that's just slid down with gravity since the last ice age flood came through here.
Okay.
God, what a beautiful afternoon.
It's a nice little, yeah, it's really nice.
The lighting is great. We can see that the layers have a slight tilt to them now, especially on the left. We can see the layers are not perfect layer cake, but they have a bit of a slope.
Yeah, that's especially enough. On the side here.
Yeah.
I'm thinking we're coming up to Douglas Canyon, but I might be wrong.
No, it's right up there.
Yeah, I see it up there.
And that's another, I don't know how gutsy you want to get over there, but that's one of my favorite little cuts.
I like it in there. I'll go in there a tiny bit, then we'll turn around. Maybe we'll go, we'll probably come back around to
that
the river.
That sounds good.
See it from the other angle. I'm going to try to change that view from the front camera. We'll wait till I turn around and get to a clear spot. I don't want to mess with it when I'm flying in a tight area.
Now, some of these folks might be able to see occasionally some little piles of gravel that you can see here and there. In fact, they've actually been quarried. It was just behind you, so
okay.
I'm a little late on my comment.
All right.
But a lot of times when you have floodwaters come around a curve like this, you're going to drop a bunch of gravels on the inside of the curve. Oh, damn it!
Isn't that beautiful up there? Yeah. Let me just turn the camera so you can all see
this
the view.
Heading up to Billingsley's Ranch, and Dave Billingsley just passed away this summer.
He
was a wonderful guy and so great to talk to over coffee. And his place there is a primo spot to study these ice age floods.
I just want to point out again from my travels, I've been to the Canyonlands a lot. In fact, I just recently put a picture from my recent trip up on Twitter.
Uh-huh.
And this, the way the rock formations are out here reminds me a lot of Canyonlands.
Yes, yes.
So let's turn back. If you follow this, there's a road, a paved road in here. If you live in the area, you can drive up there. At a certain point, it turns to gravel for 2-3 miles. It gets back to pavement, and you go up to the Waterville Plateau up here. And you can go up to Dry Falls on that route. There's a way to go up there that way. But anyway, it's neat exploring it from the ground. And there's a book about geology, the roadside geology of Washington. Do you know that book?
There's certainly a number of books. There's a new edition of Roadside Geology of Washington. She doesn't cover the floods too much.
Okay.
There's On the Trail of the Ice Age Floods by Bruce Bjornstad. And
I think that's
the one you're thinking of. Ooh, 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 ooh.
He's getting excited again.
Ooh.
So we're going into, this is Douglas Canyon. And there is a little creek in here.
Now that's a different thing, right? So now we do have a stream.
Yes.
And we don't have a coulee formation. We've got this kind of, oh, God dang it. I almost swore there.
Yeah, I know.
Look at I've never seen those before. Oh, this is so cool.
You can get to this area from the top, from the town of Douglas up in the Waterville Plateau. And you can follow this gravel road down, and I've done that with my truck. Not lately, though. But this is, if you continue following, I'm not going to go too much further because I want to get back down to the river.
Sure.
But if you continue following this down, or up, actually, you will get to the Waterville Plateau. And that's got a whole other geologic thing going on with the erratics up there and whatever else.
Yeah, for your folks who are watching right now who are super into this sort of thing, look at Douglas Creek on Google Maps. And notice how the patterns of these canyons are so different than that Moses Coulee that we were just coming up. This is not an Ice Age flood story. Super cool, not an Ice Age flood story here, because this is the gradual uplift against a lazy creek.
Okay, we're going to go up, take a little detour out of the canyon.
Wow.
We're going to go up over the top and then probably drop back down into Lower Moses Coulee. But while I'm up here, I'm going to try to change the camera angle for the front-facing camera.
All right.
And hopefully not lose it, otherwise I'll have to land out here somewhere, which, not that there's a hard place to land. It looks pretty easy out here. So let me do that. I don't know if I can do it. No, I have to shut it off. So the front view is going to go away for a while. You'll see me maneuvering. I might actually cut this out.
I can chat for a second while you're struggling with that.
Yeah, you can still talk.
So we're up and out now. We've got this great highlight view. There's some interesting patterns up here, some of them suggesting Mima mounds that some of you have heard of. I'm not sure that's what we've got here, but there's definitely some hints of that. But you might really go crazy with the Ice Age flood thing, and I don't want you to go crazy now. The floods did not cross this divide, for instance. There's no evidence of that. There's fine-grained loess and everything else. So that, to me, is also a way to show the power of these Ice Age floods. If you just swing out of a coulee, you've got a landscape that's totally different. Look at how graceful and kind of mature and kind of old it is. And then, I'm going to lose my...
Yeah, so you
I
see
can't
how
swear, can I? You, I can't swear.
You can't say the F word or the SH word.
I was just about to do
because
that,
because if you
too.
Do, then I have to flag my videos. I don't.
I am excited. How about that? Is that the clean version?
So I changed the field of view so it goes a little bit closer. Not that much closer, but I'm monitoring this camera. I'm so paranoid about losing the front-facing camera again because these flights ain't cheap, and I want to make them count. So I've just come over the top, basically cut the corner there of Douglas Canyon, back to Lower Moses Coulee, and we'll go back down the coulee. Maybe I'll fly a little bit lower. Maybe I'll fly a little lower over this side here, and we get to see some texture of the land. I don't want to fly over the middle because people live down there. I don't want to fly too close to them.
So we can add a couple more things since we're in this really famous coulee for at least geologists, Moses Coulee. It's famous for a number of reasons. One, it's second in grandeur only to the Grand Coulee. I mean, if you look on a map, it's just out there by itself. Two, we know for sure it's Ice Age flood, and we know for sure that were at least five big floods that came down there because there's five batches of gravel and boulders down there at the mouth, down there at the Columbia River that we were talking about a second ago. And three, we know it's water that came down this coulee because it's all basaltic. So in other words, if you've got a flood coming through this area, it's picking up nothing but this brown lava rock, and so it's going to drop nothing but brown lava rock. But if we head down to West Mar, I think we're going to in a second, in places like that, there's lighter colored gravels, and that means that water did not come down Moses Coulee. The last thing to say, this is the biggest mystery left in Ice Age floods geology. We still don't exactly know how the water got into this coulee and when it did.
Okay.
Everything else has been worked out pretty carefully, but this is a big question mark about the total history of this coulee.
Interesting. I was noticed we flew over near an old homestead. There's a lot of history here from settlers, and this whole area going up over the flatlands where we just came down from, and then a little bit down here, you'll find the ruins of old homestead homes, old wooden houses and things like that.
Sure.
There's a lot of that out here where you least expect it sometimes. And you don't see them from the road all that much. You usually see them from the air pretty good. And we're flying, what they do is they grow crops down here. The soil must be pretty fertile. And there's a lot of corn, and now it's late for corn, so now they're gonna be doing alfalfa probably. This is probably an alfalfa field. Back there was some guy mowing some of the alfalfa, but I didn't point it out, we were pretty high up. But this is, it's just a neat, you know, it's lined by these black rocks, dark-colored rocks, which are all volcanic. They're all basalt columns.
Yep, and each of these is a separate flow. So this fence that we're looking at is one particularly stubborn flow. But in places, there's dozens and dozens of flows stacked one on top of another. You can see some are more resistant to erosion than others. Oh, we got some horses. We got
watering
her horses. The soils in here are actually from back flooding. So some occasionally you'd have a big flood in the Columbia Valley, and there'd be so much water that it would creep back up here and drop down a bunch of windblown silt that was redeposited up in here. So there's an interesting soil story as well. I see some giant current ripples that I think exist.
Yeah, I've seen that too.
I may be making that up.
No, I see what you mean. They're not as deep as the ones down at West Bar.
Right.
I've never noticed them before. Sometimes I think you have to be a lot closer to this stuff to see it all.
Yeah.
That's why I came down a lot lower for the trip back. I just got to remember there's wires at the end.
So are you done with your cherries by now?
I'm done drying cherries. I think my audience was probably getting sick of cherry drying videos. One of them has been very popular. It's very lengthy. But here's one of those homesteads. Here, I'll fly right over the top of it. Nobody's living in there, so I can do that. Put it right in the camera. This is old wooden homes that they lived in when they were farming down here. And since then, they've obviously built new homes or moved away or whatever. And the homes just basically disintegrate. It's kind of sad.
Well, it's an amazing human history story, both before the Grand Coulee Dam Irrigation Project and after, you know. So pre-1950 and post-1950, it's a totally different world. Of course, the water is the main ingredient to success out here. The soils are fertile. It's just a matter of can you get water to them or not.
Yeah, I had somebody commented on the terrain. They were very surprised that it was so dry. You can see this valley's a perfect example. What we're flying over right now, this is the natural, is the way it naturally is. But yet up ahead, you're seeing some orchards. They would not exist if we didn't bring water in for them. So where you irrigate, it turns green, and where you don't irrigate, it eventually turns this color. In the spring, it's actually very green. It's really beautiful here in the spring. We'll have to come again in the spring.
Sounds good to me.
We'll have to go do someplace else, though. We're going to run out of topics right here. We'll have to go north.
If possible. We could fly this 12 times in a row. We probably have different things we could talk about. There's so much going on here.